I'll be proceeding to the management of severe coronal thinning and perforations in advanced patients of PUK using banana grafts. So this is a very special situation actually when it comes to dealing with coronal perforations, and because PUKs are destructive, they are inflammatory, and they involve the peripheral cornea, and they are characterized by sloughing of the corneal epithelium and keratolysis. Important thing is that more than 50% of these cases may have some other underlying disorders, and they often progress circumferentially. And these progress to then involve practically the whole of the cornea in a circular fashion. So there are several options for management of PUK. And many times we use two or more options as adjuncts. For example, we might add on peritectomy or cyanotic glue or conjunctival flaps, amniotic membranes, along with other means of performing these grafts. Important to keep in mind that there are three major components. One is infective, systemic disease, and autoimmune. All of these have to be tackled before we take up this patient for any kind of surgery. The smaller peripheral perforations, they are fairly easy to manage. And
sorry to interrupt you, sir. Your slides are not moving, sir. So just single click on your screen and make it full screen, sir.
Can you see the video?
No, sir. Your slides are not moving. Just single click on your screen.
I'm again resuming this. Can you see my slide now?
Sir, we can see your slides, but it's not moving, sir.
Make it loud, full screen.
Yeah.
This is I'm full screen. Which slide are you seeing? Slide number one.
The first slide I'm seeing now.
Let me start sharing again.
Okay, no problem. Make it full, sir.
I'm making it full. It's full screen now.
It's full screen now. Perfect.
Is it moving now?
Yes. Perfect.
Okay.
Okay. I'm muting.
So as I said, we have various options, and often we add on one or more of these options in order to treat these patients. And so these smaller perforations are relatively easier to treat because what it involves is making a peripheral graft. And many times we use a handheld skin biopsy punch for having the requisite size of the graft. But on the other hand, larger peripheral melts and perforations are much more challenging. And because they involve a huge area of cornea, they have irregular thinnings. And sometimes we don't like to go full thickness because it's so much more challenging, induces so much astigmatism, greater chances of graft rejection, vascularization, and so many other things, including the possibility of surgically induced cleft necrosis in these patients. So before we plan keratoplasty, we should investigate to rule out any systemic association. We should culture to rule out any infection and immunosuppress these patients if required to halt the lysis and prevent the progression, including SINs. Now, this is an example. So this patient of PUK presented with a peripheral iris prolapse and also suspected infiltrates. He was cultured, which was negative. Other eye was thysical. So this was very critical to try to save his eye. And what we did in this case was, so we did a sutureless lamellar banana graft for them. So as I like to do in these patients, I did do a peritectomy. In these, so it's important to do a 3 to 4 millimeter peritectomy and then clear the bed well, take out all the slough of the tissue. In this case, we did cauterize the iris to reduce the size of the iris and also to kill any epithelial cells on top of the iris. A careful measurement of the size of the graft has to be done in these cases. The grafts can be fashioned either freehand or they can be fashioned using, partial thickness cuts using handheld trephines. And in this case, then we use a guarded depth knife or any other blade in order to deepen the groove and then we do a lamellar separation using lamellar keratoplasty instruments like a Pofik knife or maybe a Tuks knife. And once the graft is shaped, then the graft is then transferred onto the eye. Something wrong with my video. Anyway, so this is the graft which was fashioned, and this graft was then transferred onto this area and stuck with the help of fibrin glue. So this patient did quite well, and this is the first post-op day of this patient, and he went on to develop a cataract and a dense nuclear sclerosis, and for which looking at the astigmatism, which was fairly regular and symmetrical, we decided to go in for, a toric intraocular lens. So in this case, I implanted a T9 Acrisoft IOL, and this patient did very well in the post-op phase and recovered a 6-9 vision. When we have to suture these patients, it's much more challenging because, these sutures cause a lot of astigmatism. Very difficult to actually get a good integrity of the graft and the host. In this case, I did try to apply a sutureless graft with a fibrin glue, but the perforation was too large. So intraoperative OCT can be very beneficial to us to judge what kind of, whether we need to intervene further or not. In this case, I had to go ahead and put some more sutures in this patient's eye in order to restore the integrity of the eye. So if you sum up the banana grafts for PUK, preferably we should do them under general anesthesia. They may be combined with peritectomy in many of these cases. We should lower the intraocular pressure and preferably by mannitol infusion before surgery, and to avoid the prolapse, intraocular prolapse and prolapse of the intraocular contents. We should prepare the recipient bed very well. So this is very important that the edges of the graft, especially scleral edge, has to be sharp. And if need be, we can use a knife to make it that way. Remove all the slough of the tissue, freshen the inner corneal edges also. Only then the graft is going to stick in case you want to apply a fibrin glue. Otherwise, it will not stick and come out. And also, when we are dissecting the graft, it should closely match the thickness. Because if the graft is too thin or if the graft is too thick, then again, there are high chances of dislodgement of the graft and it won't heal so well. So we can do that. Either we can use some kind of a Crescent knife or some lamellar instruments and then fashion it freehand. Or we can also use some of these Stefan blades. So just to sum up the kind of corneal trephination, in this case, we are going in for a full thickness corneal trephination. So we can just use a blade and then cut the graft with the help of scissors in order to achieve the desired shape. And then this can be sutured onto the cornea. I've also tried a square shaped graft or rectangular grafts, and they've done fairly well in patients of peripheral ulcerations. It's important to take good measurements, and this is a very complicated scenario, and this patient actually was Seidel's positive. We had to intervene and do something, and in this case I'm using a handheld trephine to cut the graft, and then we can just take the measurement and make another cut with the trephine to go ahead with a crescentic shaped graft. In the side. There are several techniques which have been described, like copy and fix technique, or use some kind of a pin and prick technique. Using some kind of a stencil, you can keep some offsite or plastic on top and shape it so that we get a good accurate shape. And then you can have very gratifying results in these patients because these are such challenging scenarios. And keep in mind that many of these patients can recur. So there's a one report of a recurrence rate of as much as 25% when LK was carried out for Murin's ulcer. And the mean time of recurrence was between 2 to 6 months in these patients. So to conclude, the sutureless or fibrin glue assisted semi-annular tectonic lamellar grafts are relatively simple to perform and have an excellent long-term outcomes provided we follow all the surgical principles in these patients. So this is a PUKs are very serious coronal diseases, and recurrences are common. We need to rule out systemic disease in these patients. And many techniques are available, and the sutureless semi-annular tectonic grafts or banana grafts are very effective, and they have excellent long-term outcomes in these patients. Thank you very much.